sure. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare,
tell him to stop.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, I'm about Jai Harinam Sankirtan Yajna Kira Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Kira Hare Krishna. We can move the table. Okay. Anyway. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Hare Krishna. Happy to see you all. And one second. So this, although I have a full house here, my focus is really the people of New Govardhan, and because that's where I wanted to connect. But there's a few people that sort of are looking over our shoulder. What to do? Such is life. So many people in the material world. But to be optimistic, there are more souls in the spiritual world. It says 10 times more than in the material world. So I hope everyone is doing well. Everyone is, okay. My story is so far so good. I can't really present it any better than that, you know. But I guess we're all in the same boat anyway. So far so good. Right. Let's be real. So in that sense, you know, sometimes people approach me and they got that compassionate look in their eyes and they say, I'm praying for you. And then I say, I'm praying for you too. You know? I mean, come on. You know? I'm not in a bad position, if you think about it. Right? Not too bad. You know, I messed up a little bit in this life, but, you know, once I came to Krishna consciousness, it didn't go too bad. So I'm not too worried now about that. I think I've tried. So that's what it's about. Eh? Just see, you know, life after life, and then everything goes so quick, and you go to the motions, you know, and before you know it, you have some kids. You know, it's interesting because somehow or other, because of my kind of rocking kirtan style and my mood in general, I usually attract young people, yeah? And so I meet many people before they're married, and that means before they have kids, and then time moves on and now all the kids have appeared, right? And kids everywhere now. So that's just we're seeing how we're just going through the motions of life, and it's really very involved. At the same time, though, we can appreciate, you know, as from a philosophical point of view, that we've done this so many times. So many times we have gone through this, the same thing, the same feelings, the same intensity. And it was all there. And then somehow or other, we moved on to a next birth. And we did it again. So welcome. Welcome. We're doing it again. And again and again and again and again. Life after life. That is the nature of things. I kind of like that kind of outlook because I always sort of keep an outlook like that, the temporary one, sort of at the side of my head, just so that I don't start taking things too serious. Because you know how it is, you know, it can get very serious. Very. So in Australia, of course, that doesn't go down so well. Yeah, yes. I mean, how long can we be serious, folks? You know, we don't want to sort of get carried away. You know, gotta keep it a little bit on the light side, and I'm all for that. Yeah, because that's what it is. Everything is on the light side, and Krishna is always engaged in amazing pleasure pastimes. And we're just somehow or other just outside the party for a moment. There's this big party going on, and it's like really, really amazing. And we're just for one moment stepped out, and we're somewhere in a corridor sort of talking to each other from, what do you think? So then it all comes out, everything we think. I don't know. I know. Different opinions. Some know everything, some know nothing. And like that, we are all moving along. Yeah. So the movements of time. That's what we are dealing with, and in the material world, and these movements of time. For a materialist, time is really the most, it is the most predominant force in life. There's nothing that dominates life more than time in the material world. But for a devotee, of course, it's Krishna. It dominates everything. And then what does time matter? Then time usually takes away. Kalusmi loka ksaya krit. I am time and I destroy worlds. Ooh. Time destroys worlds. That's intense. So that's intense, isn't it? But we can appreciate that time in devotional service is of a different nature, because neha bikramana sasti pratyavaya vichyate svapamapi asya dharmasya tayate mahatoba. Yet it gives us eternal benefit. So every second we spend in Krishna consciousness gave us eternal benefit. And by now it's adding up. And that's what it's about. I sometimes like to look at devotees and think, who were they in their last life? Yeah. You know, you can think, you know, like there was there's a foreign devotee from America, and you look at him and you think, he was a Baba at Govardhan who always thought of going to America. But you look at this American and you still see the Baba in him, you know? The Baba, some of the Baba is still there. Okay. Like this, who is who? Who is who? Who are we? We can look at each other and for a moment think, who are we? Who were we in our last life? Yeah. It may give a whole new dimension to your marriage. just when things are getting stale, you can start again, you know? Who are we in our last life? Relive it all. Of course, you can go for a long time reliving lives. That's not the purpose of life. But it is interesting to think about it, how we are, how we are busy over many, many lives. And the one, it starts to become constant when Krishna, when service to Krishna comes into the picture. And then everything gets positive because it builds up. little service. Some parents who will say, Jai Karo, and you do it, you know, or you bow down to, and it happens to be to a devotee. So many jais have been made to the to all kinds of deities, but then suddenly, Jai Karo to a Vaishnava. And then it builds up like that. Yes. Devotional service. It sneaks in. Of course, you know, George Harrison brought Hare Krishna to the world. And he brought it in every home. On my sweet Lord, it's I can't think in the Western world that there was anyone who did not hear my sweet Lord. Anyone said, my sweet Lord, what's that? Never heard of that. Everyone heard it. Everyone. And the holy name was there. So we heard it. It came in. And not only did we hear it, but George Harrison made it authorized because he was an authority. Whatever George said was cool. And then no one could argue with it. You know, anybody who didn't buy into it was a square. We didn't have anything to do with such a person. Yes. That's how it was. Simple. So he made it all possible. Suddenly, you could chant Hare Krishna. It was okay. It was a good thing to do. Yeah. Nothing wrong with it. Of course, you're still a little shy, especially once it started with the beat back. Oh my God, I would put it in the pocket of my coat so that no one would see it, or under the coat, like Napoleon, put my hand inside. Somehow or other, hide that hand, you know. Yeah. But gradually, I came out, you know, as they say. I came out for what I really was, you know. I've been living, you know, a life in hiding for a long time, but then, you know, I couldn't bear it no longer. And I came out. I am a Hare Krishna. A lunatic, of course. What else did you think? You know. Yeah. But then again, there's more to it, I must say. More to it than external appearance. Yeah. So that's been a great inspiration. Gosh, the neighbors are making a lot of noise down there. Oh. Yeah, and then I didn't mind anymore being, being different. No one likes to stand out too much. You're in a crowd, and you stand out so much that everyone's looking at you. Well, when I got involved in the Hare Krishna movement, it definitely was like that, and it's still... it's still an attention getter. People look at you, like, and people sometimes. I've had all kinds of reactions. One, I was standing in a line on an airport, a long line, and suddenly this man starts yelling at me and said, "You know, you're just like Al Qaeda, a religious fanatic, a terrorist." You know? And he just kept on calling me a terrorist, you know? And I tolerated it for about 5 minutes. And then finally I said very loud for everyone to hear, I said, this man is terrorizing me. And that was really good, you know? Because the crowd immediately told, hey, you know, leave him alone, you know? Hey. You know, shut up. You know. I got him on my side. It was clear who was the terrorist. You know, they got it. Yes, that was effective. Well, what to do? But mostly people are very nice. I meet mostly nice people. A few, a few sour faces. We were in Paris and we were doing Harinam. And we're coming past this street and there had been a concert, a band had played. But the band was packing up. And the area where the band had played had been marked off with this plastic checkered tape, you know, that like police uses and for traffic control. So they had this plastic tape, and the band had packed up, but the conga player was still there. So I had an accordion player who was doing reggae, you know, rhythms, a la Sri Palat, and he was good at it. Cat copy. So he was doing his reggae, so the conga guy, you know, immediately picked it up, right? So they start going and the whole thing started to take off and it's a lot of fun. Then there was an older man and he just walked straight through the ribbon, you know, and broke the ribbon. So I immediately called out, said, "Bravo, bravo, bravo, you are number one." Because he just broke the finish line. "You're number one. You are the most sour man in Paris." And then the guy goes, "Saint-Julie, Saint-Julie, Saint-Julie," which means monkey business, right? Monkey business, monkey business. He had to, you know, he had to call it something to justify his outrageous behavior, right, of being so sour. But he got the point. He was the most sour man in Paris. And we had fun. So that's generally how it has been. Krishna consciousness. There's been a lot of fun, actually. I have met so many amazing people, really, really nice people, right? And because, yeah, devotees are trying to be nice. They're trying to do something nice. I mean, not everyone's always nice, but, you know, but still, there is something inside where a devotee is basically trying to improve himself, at least. So that's nice, even if he's like Hiranyakasipu's little brother. Still, if he's working on it, right, then we can appreciate that he is on the way. So he's nice. Little Hiranya. He's okay. He's working on it, you know, like that. Yes. Okay, so that's sort of my introductory talk to break the ice. And what I wanted to do was just start some conversation. Yeah, and I'm not taking any questions from the floor. I'm really getting it from online. So whoever online wants to say something. Okay, if you're shy like Nayana, probably you wouldn't be able to open your mouth, you know. But others surely will. Yeah. Okay. Gunamani has a hand. Let's go. Ask to unmute. Yep.
Hare Krishna Pumaraj. Thank you for giving us that time. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah, very loud actually, and everyone else too.
Okay. My question was, many of our children are still very young, so they might not remember a lot of the interactions they had with you. So I was wondering, how would you like to be remembered, or is there a message that you would like us to pass to them when they are older?
you know, like a great saint, of course, you know, who descended directly from the spiritual world, and wherever I stepped spontaneously, lotus flowers started blossoming. Yes. And, you can fill in the details because you're an artist, but something along those lines. I mean, you know. Yeah. Now, what shall we do? Should I make a special video for the children? I mean, you can do a special 5-minute, like, for the children, yeah.
That would be nice, if you can.
If I can. Okay, I'll think about it.
Yeah.
I went to the school in Ugovardhan, and I don't know, some of you might have been there as kids, you know, possibly. But I went in, and I'm sort of looking at the kids, you know, who are like kind of rebellious a bit, and the teachers are like sort of introducing me formally, right, very formally. And sort of behind their back, they didn't see me because they looked at the kids. I was making faces, and the kids immediately understood, he's one of us. So, you know, we immediately had a great time, and all the kids, you know, and I was making more, and I was like making more and more funny looks and faces, and the kids were going wild, and they're rolling over the floor, and, you know, and the teacher said, we don't know what's happening. It's so embarrassing. They never behave like this. So I enjoyed that visit to the Ugovardhan school very much. Yeah, that was a fun one. Yeah. And it's pretty good. Yeah, what to do. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the movement is like that. There are many devotees who've never met Tamal Krishna Maharaj. Yeah. I mean, to me, that's something like inconceivable. There's devotees that have never met Brahmananda Prabhu. There's devotees that have never met Bhakti Tirtha Swami. And you go like, wow, you never met Bhakti Tirtha Swami. Wow. So yeah, time is like that. And then one day they said, no, I never met Gunamani. And then, dear Gunamani, how would you like to be remembered?
As someone who's trying. Oh no, actually as someone I have not thought about it. I'm sorry. I don't know. I'll get back to you in 5 minutes.
Okay. I won't let you off the hook now. Huh? 5 minutes. I got witnesses.
But maybe as somebody who was too much of a dreamer. Like, you know how when you join the ashram, you have that impression that in this life, you got to make it back to Godhead. It's just got to be a smooth.
Yeah, it's a smooth ride.
Easy
breezy. Good. Yeah, sure. Yeah, that's where we're going. Back to Godhead.
But then these ones come in the picture.
Yeah, that one's also going back to Godhead.
Sorry?
I mean, you have to translate that.
I'll put it on mute maybe. Can you say Hare Krishna to Guru Maharaj?
Okay. And just that I did that, don't anybody dare cut that out and make a separate clip of that. Whoever does that gets the biggest trouble. Okay. Okay, Nayana, what's up? You're driving in a fancy car.
Can I Maharaj?
How you going?
Yeah, good. Just down the beach.
Oh, down the beach. Where else, huh? Doing the food court or what? We can't hear you anymore. Oh, wow. Kulangata or what? Looks a bit like Kulangata. Huh? Which beach is it? To me, it looked like Kulangata. It's all green grass. That's what they got over there. Okay. You sound like you're in a tin can, which is true. You're in a car. In a car. It's actually a tin can. It may look nice, but that's what it really is.
Can you hear me?
If you speak close to whatever device you're using, then probably we can. No, but he's speaking far from the device. Then it gets worse. Okay, well, too bad. Nah, that's okay. It wasn't convincing. Yeah, anybody else? How's Garuda also in the car? Nobody's talking.
Hare Krishna Guru Maharaj, Karunandan, Dasya.
Yeah, okay. Hare Bol.
Hare Krishna. Yes, we are trying and trying to be nice people, and sometimes we're not so nice to people. The question would be maybe even in a position of management or looking after other people. And sometimes the toad can come out of the mouth and it's hard to catch it. So just some tips on making apologies bridging gaps.
Apologies.
Bridging gaps.
Yeah. Apologies are only meaningful when they when we mean it, yeah? When the heart felt, when we really feel, you know, like I shouldn't have done that, and then the apology can be meaningful. Otherwise, if it's just some cosmetic thing, then nobody will buy it. Everyone will immediately pick up, this is fake, you don't mean it, right? Yeah, so apologies means you have to be quite quite generous. You have to be ready to put your ideas and opinions aside. Yeah? And it's hard to do this kind of half apologies. For me, I'm really sorry. I smacked you in the mouth. I shouldn't have done it. but of course, you know, you were totally obnoxious. But then again, that doesn't justify me, you know, just losing self-control like that. You know, I should have been deeper rooted in yoga. And I should have just tolerated your obnoxious presence. That wouldn't do. That wouldn't do. You know, that's the kind of thing where we are casting some blame on the other person. And there may be some blame in the other person. But when you start apologizing, then even if there is a fault on the other side, you can't mention it. That's where the generosity kicks in. You can't mention anything about it. And then you just have to take the blame. Oh, gosh. So apologies, you know. If you really have to. No, it's good. Anyway, how about just making friends again instead of apologizing? Personally, I apologize sometimes, but not all the time. And some people, they apologize a few times a day. And that's a bit much, if you ask me. But every once in a while, a heartfelt apology, yeah. But not too often. That's my 5 cents worth. Yeah. Otherwise, how are things? Summertime. Not bad. There was a Ratiachin surfers or something. I saw a picture somewhere.
Yes, on the Gold Coast. And
wow.
New Govardhan's going really well. We just had Nityananda Trailers again. Mm-hmm. Krishna pads filling up from bhaktas from Krishna Village.
Cool. Really nice. Yeah. I wish we could have made it for the Ratiyatra. I'm missing Ratiyatras.
Yeah.
Vrindavan's not a place for Ratiyatra because it's about bringing Krishna back to Vrindavan and he's already here. So, therefore, it's not really a Ratiyatra place. I miss Ratiyatra. Yeah. Yeah, it was nice. I saw the Ruchis were there. Jananda Maharaj was in town. I mean, everybody knows everything about everybody, isn't it, these days? And see it all on the internet. Okay, let's move on. Yep. He's unmuted. No, he's at ask to unmute.
Unmuted. Hare Krishna.
Hare Bo. There you go.
First of all, Guru Maharaj, I'd like to apologize for my wrong name being presented on the screen because I had technological issues just a minute ago and had to change my old iPad. So I'm sorry about that. In line with the last question.
Yeah. It's okay.
So so it's Krishna Keshava.
Yeah. Better than Chris. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and actually that's quite poignant because I'd like to say in your comment about coming out, it's actually for me been very much a coming out in the last day or two. So, and I use that term to a few people at this who I sometimes see they have a fire in the evenings and I go by with my drum. And yesterday I came by and I felt really like I was, and I talked about coming out and we actually had a bit of a chant and chanted some Hare Krishna mantra. It was really nice, and one of them wants to join in more. And so it was just poignant that you mentioned that just today. So thank you.
Interesting.
And it's actually in line with my wife and I went up to the temple just a few days ago, just last weekend, for the Kirtan Mela for Advaita Acharya's day, Disappearance Day, And she had a great time. First time in about a year we'd been up together, and we sat in there, had a great time. So and that for me, we agreed. You know, after that we agreed that she'd try and call me Krish at least, rather than Chris, and she stuck with that. So we're making moves.
Progress, eh? Yeah, Chris is becoming Krish.
Krish. We're getting close.
That's good. That's nice.
And I just like to do more, you know, just going out with the drum and chanting on the beat. Just before this call, I just did the same, did that with a microphone. So it was cool. It was nice. It was a feeling coming out.
Yeah. Very nice. Yeah. Mm. That way, life becomes simple. Yeah, it's nice.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm.
Facade is always complicated, isn't it? It's like for everybody, you know, playing a role and then playing different roles for different people, and then you hope they're not going to meet each other. And if they get close, you have to really do something, you know. Create some drama, you know. When they're just about to meet each other, you just faint on the ground. Ah! Something very dramatic. And all the attention goes away from that unwanted meeting.
Yeah.
Yeah. So many tricks you have to pull out of the pocket. Yeah. So, no, it's nice if we're just straightforward. Are you a vegetarian? Yeah, I'm a vegetarian. Yeah, it's pretty good. You don't drink? No, don't drink. Not a drop. Never. No water, nothing. haven't drunk for years. Anyway, you know, somehow or other, it's not so bad, actually. And when you talk about it, people find it, some find it a little strange, but then many are saying, well, that's interesting. That's interesting.
Yeah. I think I was inspired by one of your last discourses. When one of the last Zoom meetings, you were saying how present it as it is and not water it down. And I've been going to different yoga things, and I'm just trying to wean in there, but just presenting it as it is, and it's so much better. I like it. So yeah, that's it. It's easy that way. No decisions to make.
Yeah, like that, you know,
it's not so hard, yeah.
And then the relationships get real, you know. You get some people who don't like it. Anyway, they don't like it. Okay, that's clear then, right? And then there's other people that really like it, and then they are real friends. You know? Then they become real friends. They become people that actually you can really share with. Whereas keeping these. These relationships, we hide our identity and we just keep some sort of friendly relationship with people who want you, then you play a role and it's not really what you want to be. So with those people, you cannot be yourself. So the good thing of being straightforward is just we can, you know, make real relationships with people. So yeah, I'm
thank you, yeah.
It took me a while to get there. As I said, I was hiding my beat bag, and not only that. Hiding.
I did have a question, but it's okay. I think someone else will probably turn now. But I did have a
question. Go ahead.
Could I ask a question?
Please.
Yeah. I wondered about it for a long time since being in Vrindavan and walking around the gallery in Prabhupada Samadhi. Looking at the parampara laid out in that square. Mm-hmm. And it almost seems like is it Madhavacharya or no, before, since Vyasa Day down, it seems almost like a kind of a time is real time. And before that, with Narada and Brahma and Krishna, it seems like it's an eternity or millions and millions of years. So,
yeah. It's like this.
Yeah, I don't know. Is there a?
Yeah.
Can you?
It is. It takes a while from Krishna to to Narada to from Krishna to Brahma to Narada to Vyas. That takes time, and then from Vyas to Madhava also takes time because there's a huge gap. Madhava, there's thousands of years between Madhava and Vyas.
Yeah.
So in the early stages of this sampradaya, it's not exactly, and this person lived 60 years, and that one lived 70 years, and that one lived, you know. And we have a whole line of clear life descriptions and so on. No, there are some big time gaps. As far as Madhvacharya meeting Vyasadeva, it said Vyasadeva is still there in the Himalayas now. But we can go to his cave if you like, or you can go. I'm not going. But it's very nice. It's way up there, up from Badrinath, and it's high up in the Himalayas. It's a real expedition. And then you go to Vyasadeva's cave, and who knows? He's supposed to be still there somewhere near there. So Madhvacharya met him, and that's, you know. So yeah, how that was possible, that's only possible that Vyas lives a long time and Madhvacharya was very powerful. So that connection is very transcendental. So yeah, there you have to have a little bit of faith, yeah, undoubtedly. If you're skeptical, then we kind of look at that. How did that happen? But so when we look at the parampara historically, then we see these time gaps, you know, between Krishna, Brahma, Narada, and up to Vyas. and that would be us to Madhava. But we don't just look at it historically. We also look at it philosophically. And then philosophically, we begin to see this philosophy, it makes sense. It's sort of, it is very nicely to apply this philosophy. If you live by it, you're actually getting a better quality of life. And it somehow or other kept being preserved generation after generation. That in itself is also amazing. So like this, we can appreciate that the parampara has two sides, the historical side and the contents, the message that is being carried by. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is your hand back up, Yadu, just to wave at me? No. Ah, ha, 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 ha. It's the other half. The better one.
Sorry about Maharaj.
Yes.
I was wondering what your thoughts are on astrology and how much it affects us as devotees. I know a lot of devotees can get really caught up in I'm in this terrible period, and that's why I'm suffering, or you know. And I was just wondering, your own analogy has still impacted you personally, or do you feel like it's not really relevant?
It has some relevance. It is astrology is showing karma, so we're still having some diminished karmic reactions at the moment, right? So astrology can see that, at least it can, but it cannot see Krishna's intervention. So not everything that the astrology shows may happen, but it does show that some bad karma is building up, and can expect some trouble, right? So it may have some effect, but Krishna can intervene and everything changes. And in the end, Krishna will just get rid of all this karma. In my case, I'm definitely getting some diminished karmic reactions. Yeah, so there's something there. Something. Then I, over the years, I met many astrologers, this, that, you know, and then and they looked at my chart, and also in the year 94, they looked at my chart, famous astrologers, famous ISKCON astrologers, and then in 95, January, I got shot, and no astrologer told me, you know, and they go like, well, you know, that wasn't exactly a small thing, right? That should have shown in the astrology like a mountain, you know, like should have been, that is a big thing, the elephant in the room, you know, come on, right? But nobody ever caught that, right? So a little bit of salt is appropriate, but you know, a bit of astrology, yeah. But then how far do you want to go? You know, then we're going to do the tarot cards. And then, you know, there's this lady, you know, no, really. She's a mystic. You got to meet her. It's amazing.
the Bhrigu
in India, you know, and it's really interesting. Because everybody, they tell you what you were, and either in your last life you were some prince, you know, or a princess, and or you were a sannyasi, but something went wrong, and then you had to take another birth, right? So it's interesting. Everyone was a prince or a princess, or some great sage, and nobody was, you know, a dog or a cat in a devotee's house, right? How about that? You know, what if we were a cat in our last life and getting Krishna Prasadam milk? And then as a result, he became a devotee this life. Must be some cats must have turned into devotees. Yeah. Some are still a little, a little of the cat's still there. Yeah.
Is it true as well that children don't receive karma in this life until they're a certain age?
Say that again. I missed the beginning. Say it again. It was a little bit unclear on the.
Someone mentioned to me the other day that children don't start getting karmic reactions in this life until they're a certain age.
No, that's not true. No, not correct. No, even, yeah. I mean, some kids already get it at birth, you know, they have a birth defect or something like that, right? Clearly some karma is there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, okay. Yeah.
But it's more the point of creating karmic reactions, huh? A little bit like maybe in the animal kingdom, there is no new creation of karmic reaction, just basically.
Okay. New karma. That's Janani Vasa's voice is coming from the heavens.
Well, I'm not sure about that.
Well, there's no picture, but whatever it is, but it was. That's not our philosophy. Yeah, I don't know who's saying that. Okay, well, we are not accepting that as Vaishnavas. No, we don't. We don't. A child can make karma. And the proof is of Yamaraj and that Muni, Manduka Muni, who as a child was piercing an insect, right? And then later was punished for it. So in our philosophy, a child pierced an insect with a thorn or something, and in next life got a reaction, was almost pierced with a lance. So that's the proof that in our tradition, children also Yamaraj. Yeah, but at the same time, because kids, they have not come to pragya at the age of 5, you are at the stage of pragya, of understanding what's going on. I mean, if a kid burns down a house and it's only 3 years old, I mean, the kid didn't know what it was doing, right? Somehow or other, it didn't come like, I'm going to burn down that house. The kid, somehow or other, it happened. So many things happen. So if you don't know what you're doing, then you're also not culpable. Yeah. Yeah. So how's Jananivas? Good to see you in Australia.
I'm good, Maraj.
Oh, yeah, you're good. Huh? All good?
Yeah, it's a bit, you know, adjusting time to the circumstances of having a baby.
A baby, and, yeah, right.
Yeah, baby. And
everyone's being
in the
final
stages of the studies. So,
Sorry?
And being in my final stages of my studies at the same time, which means a lot of practical exams and stuff like that. And
Do you have a soundproof room? Do you have a soundproof room?
No, I don't. And that's part of the problem, I guess. No, but it's okay. You know, it's interesting. Yeah. This fatherhood gives you a certain willpower to just do what's necessary to be done without getting too mental about it. That's at least my experience. And I'm quite happy that this mechanism seems to be put in place. It's sort of possible to deal with everything in a quite calm way, even though it's a lot. So that's nice.
Yeah.
The thing is, beyond living this material life and having a daughter and everything, I'm also trying to be one of these devotees. which doesn't seem to get any easier with the circumstances being so full on. And I just actually had a talk to Jayananda from, you know, Sweden, Finland.
Uh-huh.
And it was very interesting because we were talking about yoga. There might come up another yoga teacher training in Radadish.
Okay.
That we're going to do together. And then we were talking about, you know, yoga in context of family life. And he was just making that nice comment that for him, like, it's easy to balance in like a yoga pose, but it's way more difficult to balance your life when there is a kid around, you know. So he's saying it's like a very high form of yoga to manage the mind in a way that you can balance all these, like you sometimes talk about these juggling balls. I feel there's a lot of balls in the air right now, and it's sort of it's a form of yoga. So I hope that my practice expands just by trying to be a dad.
Okay, dad.
Anyway,
so, that was definitely, you should we'll cut this out as a clip. Yeah. Sharing his realizations. Yeah. Yeah, that would be nice. Yeah, very good. Nayana likes it. He's someone really got saved.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I think it's really interesting to also see everything in life as a practice. You gave me that book about puja, you know, where you start getting up and paying obeisances to Mother Earth at first, like to know, okay, every step I take on you now is actually like a far out thing that happens because I'm connected to this amazing Earth who is a devotee in herself. And like that, to walk through life, not only when I have my beat back in hand or I'm on my yoga mat that I'm feeling like I do a spiritual practice, but more like in every interaction that we do. And I feel that's something I'm so grateful of having learned a little bit from you, I think, because you're often so casual with people. And like when I traveled with you, I once asked you that question, why do you often like not talk about Krishna with the people? And it was really hard to understand, but it makes total sense to me now that even to just build strong relationships that make then also possible a close, trusted connection or so, you know, that we are out there and not only think if I talk about Krishna or have my beat back or do my practice, but everything that I do influences everything I do. So, and influences everything the other person does. So trying to see everything, also walking around late at night with a baby as being spiritual in terms of the right context. Sure. I don't know, maybe that's too vague.
Everything to be connected to Krishna. Right? So kids and everything. Yeah. Nothing vague. Yeah. Nirbandha Krishna Sambandha. Yukta Vairagya Uchite. Yeah, that's nice. Yeah, I'm nicely and happily situated in the renounced order of life. I love it. It's definitely, it's really great when there are no kids in the house, and what can I say? Like kids? No, I like kids a lot when they're in someone else's house, not in my house. That's it, you know. It's great. I like to play with kids, as I said, you know, like when I went to the school in Ugovardhan, they knew I was one of them, one of the rebels. But some peace also is nice. So now, I still, considering all the ashrams, I think sannyasa is the best. Anyway, that you can think about for later. That's for Ron, right? According to Rupa, that's old-fashioned Australian. That one's for Ron. Could be, because it was ages ago since I learned the lingo. Okay. Yeah. Okay, well, someone else has to speak. Oh, there's a hand. Yeah, Amarendra Krishna.
Hare Krishna Maharaj.
Yes, Hare Bol.
Thank you for this time. This is very special for us because we have not spent much time with you. Maharaj, just a small question. I have a post office in Gold Coast.
Okay.
And I put some books in front of my counter.
Mm-hmm.
And when all our customers comes and everything, generally I talk to them, but I generally keep like a small books like yoga,
yeah.
Chant and Be Happy, mm-hmm. or, you know, the higher taste.
Sure.
But as I was just with the Jananivas Mahaprabhu was, you know, telling, I don't introduce Krishna much to the people when, you know, when the general public comes.
Yeah.
So do you think, shall I introduce much or shall I just keep it as it is with the yoga and everything? Because I just keep as a meditation things and everything. Yeah. I just speak to them.
It's a post office. I think so. I think you can't mix everything, you know, and then your whole life becomes a mess. So since it's a post office, I think keep it as a post office. And a few few books in the post office, that's okay. But for the rest, it's a post office. But the books are there, and some people who are showing some interest, they can, they'll find their way. Yeah. So as Jananivas was saying, you know, like, I don't also always like the completely direct approach. Now, at one point, I was traveling with a servant, with a devotee, my assistant, and there were three of us sitting on a row. And, you know, I sort of, as an experienced traveler, had the aisle seat. So I had the aisle seat. So it meant my servant in the middle, and then some regular person on the window. So this person sitting on the window, and suddenly my servant goes, "Can you chant Hare Krishna?" And this person is sitting there like, everyone wants to say, "Help!" and doesn't know what to say. So then the devotee goes, "Say ha." And I was cringing, you know, as a guy's like, I don't know him. We're not traveling together. It's like, never met the guy in my life. I have nothing to do with this. Absolutely nothing, you know. Oh, gosh. But then sometimes, he did it several times, you know, and sometimes there was someone who really surrendered, you know, and they became like their guru almost, you know. They were like following him to the luggage belt and still asking questions about life and so on. So for some people, this very direct approach seemed to work very well. For most people, not. So if you're running a post office, I think just
keep it simple.
Yeah.
The one thing I want to share, like one day me and my colleague, like I own the post office. So one of the customers, she just came and they were talking about the meal that, okay, what are you going to cook in the evening and everything. And my colleague said, oh, he doesn't eat meat. He is pure vegetarian. Okay. And then she was just asking, what do you eat in your vegetarian meal and everything. Then I just took out the higher taste. I gave it to her. She liked that book. She paid also $5 to me. And next, I think so after 3 days, she came and she showed me she made pakoda and she showed me pictures of pakoda. Mm. And she loved it so much.
Good.
So that was...
Yeah, that's very nice.
That's something very... Yeah. So I said, this is something working here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very good. Very nice.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Suvarna.
Hi, Raj.
Yeah.
Haribol. Yeah, I really appreciate talking about different sort of outreach styles depending on our nature. I've been thinking about it a lot. And in motherhood, it changes, you know, how much time you can spend with people, in what capacity. And, you know, there's the more direct ways. We have one devotee here who sells whole sets of Bhagavatam while he's milking the cows. And, you know, that's a very direct method. Whereas for me, I'm still trying to find my way, because I feel more reserved And I think being at New Govardhan, there's already, Krishna is already everywhere. And I think it's easy for volunteers and visitors to search out Krishna very simply. So for us living here, perhaps, yeah, it's more about developing relationships with them, just asking how they are, things like that. Mm-hmm. Do you have any advice for us in our situation, you know, Krishna Village, how to interact with the guests and the villagers here without being too, you know, intense or not intense enough?
Yeah, I agree with you that we don't want to come in with a ton of bricks, and that there's a whole Krishna world there, and anybody who comes there will automatically absorb so many things. And so make him feel comfortable to begin with, and give that some time. at one point, though, we want to go a little deeper. Yeah. So, I mean, when the relationship begins to develop, we can also speak about something that's a little bit more meaningful. Yeah. So at one point, we have to get a little bit more direct. This is always the thing with indirect preaching, is how long are you going to do it? When are you actually going to, yeah, get to a little more substance? Huh? But you can, first of all, make a relationship with people and show that you're a human being, that you're not like some extraterrestrial who's just landed, but that you are a normal person, and that you also, at the same time, are doing this mantra meditation or whatever people call it, yeah, and that you that it really did a lot for you. So somewhere we can discuss some substance at one point. If it's only just buttering people up, how are you? Nice to see you again. Hey, John, great, welcome. Oh yeah, lovely, you're always coming. At one point, a little more should also be there. But not necessarily the style. Can you say ha? Yeah. Good. Thank you. Nayana.
Mm-hmm. I guess, Raj, can you hear me this time?
Oh, we can hear you like anything. Full force.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
Maharaj, as a collective group of your disciples, as a collective, what would you like to see from us moving forward, working as a collective? That's my question.
Well, you know, there's unity in diversity, right? Everybody is different. And at the same time, somehow or other, you all got a connection with me. And I hope that you can all keep some sort of friendship, you know, and be nice to each other, I think. And, you know, have good relationships amongst each other, and do something for Prabhupada, you know, just something. Do something that Prabhupada would have really liked. That I also have tried to do in my life. You know, I've tried in my life to, do things that meant something for Prabhupada. And I would like my disciples to also start thinking about that. So it's not just, how do I live a life in KC? That's one thing, but maybe also, something. Something. Prabhupada was, a tireless preacher, Nothing. He just always tried again and again to bring in some to bring in more and more people. So if we can also encourage others somehow or other, new people, that'd be nice. Mm-hmm. Something.
Yeah.
Yeah. So go on Sangatan, Nayana.
We'll do, Maharaj.
Okay. Yeah, I went all around. So I hope everybody else is okay. I'm, I just, I like this this approach of the small meetings, because it's just a bit more intimate. I mean, these bigger Zoom meetings became like public programs, practically speaking. And then this is a bit more personal. So it's nice to see everyone. Some are busy doing things, so their screens are not on or have a bad connection. I see Madurangi is there. I stole your husband. He's actually quite nice. I think I'll keep him a bit longer. Is it okay? But eventually I'll send him back to you, don't worry. Yeah. I hope you're okay without him for now. Yeah. He's smiling right now. Yeah, no response. Nah. Okay. Anyway, they say if you don't say anything, then that means you agree. That's good. Okay, so I'm going to wrap it up. I'm going to wrap it up, and I'll see you all again, either online or in Sri Vrindavan Dham. We're coming out of the winter now. It's getting good. Actually, it's tomorrow will be or today even 26 degrees, tomorrow 27. Then we're going on an excursion tomorrow. Just to Kushamsharavar, nothing's better, but just to be outside, a little claustrophobic in this flat all the time. Okay, Gunamani, you have the last word. So what do you really want to be? How do you want to be remembered? That was it.
Yes, I thought about it. Thank you for giving me the time. At the time of my initiation, you told me that I got a lot of mercy from Lord Nityananda. Now I want you to go and spread Lord Nityananda's name in your own way. So then, because I'm not a very good book distributor, you said, oh, it doesn't have to be through book distribution. So I've been thinking about this for 15 years. So I came with my own way. I want to be remembered as someone who spreads the name of Nitai through my artwork. So please give me your blessing.
Very good. So may your artwork, go everywhere. Yeah. Very nice. Yeah, it's really nice that you're doing it, your artwork. Highly. Okay, yeah, I'm sure Gunamani Nitai. Is that how you're on Facebook? Or what's your page called?
On Facebook it's Gunamani Nitai. And on Instagram is gm.nitai.
gm.nitai on Instagram.
Yeah, and that's the name of my business as well.
gm.nitai.
Yeah, because I really wanted to keep that name of Nitai. I was thinking, even if nothing else, even if somebody doesn't even buy something, at least they see the name of Nitai.
Ah, very good.
Because he saved me. He saved me, and he will save everyone else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very good. Yeah. Yeah, I purposely put it there.
I know. Now I can. Now I see why.
Mm.
I was jumping on the trampoline.
Hi, there you are.
I figured out how to use Zoom. It took me a second.
Oh, I see. I see.
I just wanted to say, Rupa's all yours as long as you need him.
Oh.
I'll just got to make an excuse to work and I'll come visit soon enough.
Ah, yeah. Anyway. No, it's nice. We're having a good time with him. But of course, you know, he even gave me some cheese this morning.
I'm glad. Gotta have some cheese. Makes life better.
Yeah, definitely. I agree. Yeah. Sometimes you just say, to hell with it all, and let's have some cheese. Isn't it, Nayana? Yeah. No, so it was nice. And yeah, we're doing a big puja every morning. Yeah. Okay. And there was something in the chat from Parma Karuna. What's that? Oh, thank you, Gurudev. Okay, Madhurangi. But if it gets too much, I'll send him back. Huh?
If it gets too much, I'll just move over there.
Ah, okay. That's good. Yeah, okay.
He's happy, Maharaj, so I'm happy.
Okay, well, thank you.
If you're not happy with him, then you send him back.
Okay, I will. One way, you know. Yeah. All right. Okay. Very nice. Thank you so much, everybody. And yeah, it was nice to be with you all. And we're going to pack up now. And see you again on, well, tomorrow there's a program on, yeah, it starts at around 10, I guess. Our time, 10 Indian time. So that means you're, what, 5 hours ahead? Five and a half. Okay, so 3:30. We're 3:30 starting sort of at Kusham Saravar, live program, whatever it's going to be, with Jayadvaita Swami, which means there will be questions and answers. We can. And you know his, by now you might know his Q&A style. It's like table tennis, like next. Yeah, he likes Q&A. He can't get enough of it. So that's what we're doing tomorrow. Okay, thank you very much and see you soon. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Okay. Yay. Oh, missed. I tried.
Okay?
Yeah, it worked good. No noise from the mic. Someone brought a Kemper burning.
Yeah, that's so.
It's intense.
Yeah.
I mean, the whole room is like really camping nuts.
Yeah. It's good for brahmachari.
Oh, you're actually busy now.
We just, I want to do.